That you joined us. Shout out to Scarf Weather. Okay, never mind. I wore a scarf. It's exciting. If it's your very first time, welcome to North Rock. We don't always just talk about scarves. We use music as a way to express our worship to God. We celebrate our faith with music. Music is visceral. There's something very deep that resonates when we sing. And so we love to use that as a way to worship. So we're going to sing a few more. Then Pastor Brad's going to come talk to us. We'll have you out of here in just about an hour, all right? Come on, let's do another one. Put your hands together. Here we go.
Shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns. unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. And we'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God.
Sing that again.
Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable.
Father, we open our hearts to you this morning. We open our hearts to your truth today. Open our hearts this morning. We surrender our hearts and our lives to what you have to say this morning, the truth that's in your presence, the truth about who we are in you, Father. Because we know this, Lift your hands with us and sing this.
You are more than enough. You are Him. You are Lord. You are whole. You are grace. Oh, you're all I have. You're everything.
Good to see you guys. You have a good Thanksgiving? Right? Ate a lot. Now your body feels like it's time for hibernation, but you have to go to work tomorrow. It's terrible. Great to see you guys. My name is Brad, and I'm excited to talk to you guys today about our final part of How to Be Brave. Before we get started, though, I want to tell you about a couple of quick things. Number one, we want you to help us get the word out about NorthRock, and you can do that by using social media. So when you get a chance, take an Instagram photo, tweet, jump on Facebook and check in. Let people know that you're part of an incredible church here at North Rock, and let's spread the word. And as you can tell, we're running out of room slowly, and God's doing big things, which takes me to the second thing I want to tell you about, and that is our Beyond Christmas expansion offering that's coming up in 2 weeks. And this offering is all about two things. It's about missions and expansion. It's about helping people in other countries and here in San Antonio, and it's helping us grow as a church. My wife and I have been at North Rock for about 8 months now, and it's amazing in 8 months how much this church has already grown. And so we're just asking you to pray about and talk with your family and see what God would put on your heart to give for that special offering. And let me tell you, if you've been here very long at all, you know that we have pastors and leadership here at North Rock that have big vision and big dreams and big goals, and they're not afraid to go after them, and you're helping lead the way. So thank you for that, and we're excited about that. So that's in 2 weeks. But today we're going to finish up How to Be Brave, and let me start by asking you this. How many of you hate bad news? All right, you hate bad news? If you like bad news, need some help. But I don't like bad news, and I don't do well with bad news. Sometimes people like to sugarcoat bad news, and they say, hey, I've got good news, and I've got bad news. What they're really saying is, I have bad news. I can give you an example. If you're a Cowboys fan, and many of you aren't now, but if you're a Cowboys fan, I could say, hey, I've got good news. Tony Romo's going to throw 2 touchdowns on Thursday. I've got bad news. He's going to throw them to the other team. Right? That's not good news and bad news. That's just bad news. And, man, what a year for our Cowboys. But, hey, at least we got our Spurs. They know how to win games, right? All right. Awesome. So I don't do well with bad news, and I've found a little illustration to help you see that we don't do well with bad news starting at an early age. And Jimmy Kimmel has a late night show, and he does this terrible thing once a year where he asks parents the day after Halloween to tell their kids they ate all their candy. Give them some bad news and see how they react. And I want you to take a look at this video real quick. So those are just great. My wife and I are expecting our first child here in a few weeks, and I just can't wait till he's about 3 or 4 and I can do that to him every Halloween. It's going to be awesome. I love the two little ones that are like in harmony as they like walk off. Anyway, we don't do well with bad news at an early age, and a lot of times the experiences we have make us fear bad news in the future. Jess, my wife, when we first started dating, and she told me after the first service, not to make her sound like a jerk, but she's not a jerk, but when we first started dating, she used to do this fun little thing where she would break up with me, and I deserved it, rightfully so, but she always did it by using a phrase, we need to talk, okay? Oh, it makes me cringe even saying it out loud. And so years later, after many breakups and many talks, she'll text me or call me now and be like, hey, we need to talk. I'm like, oh my God. What's happened? What have I done? And, you know, I'll call her, get my composure. Babe, what's going on? Babe, we need to talk about where we're going to eat tonight. Like, oh, thank goodness. But that bad news that I used to get years ago, it still affects me today. When I was 21 or 22, I'd been working for a software company for about a year, and we had a Monday off, so we had a three-day weekend, and I decided I wanted a four-day weekend. So I did what any young man does. I called in sick. And so we used an instant messaging program to communicate at work, and I logged on at home and messaged my friend that worked there. I'm like, hey, you know, hope you enjoy working today while I'm already off for the four-day weekend. What I didn't know is he had got up from his computer, and my boss had walked by and seen my name on the screen and sat down and began to have a conversation with me. And begin to say things like, how do you even work for that guy? Your boss is such a jerk. How do you deal with him? Yeah, and I responded in the way I wanted to. Like, I don't know. He is a jerk. And just said terrible things. And he closed up with this. By the way, this is your boss. We'll chat on Tuesday. Can you imagine with me how good my four-day weekend ended up being? It was terrible. It was the worst 4 days. All I could do was anticipate the bad news that was coming. Believe it or not, though, he didn't fire me, and I ended up working there 13 years. But I was terrified for my life. But we live in a world where the anticipation of bad news sometimes trumps the reality of bad news. And example of that is, you know, those of you that have kids, I see it all the time. You fear for your kids. Be careful. Hey, don't do that. Hey, don't talk to them. Hey, get off that. I mean, we've seen it happen. We've seen them fall. We've seen the car wrecks. We've seen the news. So we're fearful for our kids. Or maybe if you're like me, you fear going to the dentist. Man, is there anything worse? But I remember I had a bad toothache a while back, or it's been several years ago, and I decided the best way to handle the fact that I thought I might have a cavity is just to not go to the dentist so he can't tell me I have a cavity, right? I really showed my tooth to his boss and did do that. But we're fearful of going to the dentist or the doctor because we fear the bad news that they may have. Students in the room. Is there anything worse than that Friday when they tell you the report cards are coming out? Terrible. You know that your life is going to be over for the next few weeks when you turn that into your parents, but we fear bad news. And I think there's a pretty obvious reason why, and it's this, that bad news sells. Bad news sells. I got on CNN.com, and I just wanted to give you an example, and I know there's a lot going on in the world right now, but I went on and I just wrote down every top article that they had, and here they are. Racism, a growing problem in the U.S. Worldwide travel alert over the holidays. France wants war. Russian jet shot down by Turkey. Bus explodes, 11 dead. And I literally had, there's more, but I had to scroll way down at the bottom in like the footer area that no one goes, and I found an article called The Hero of the Year. That was it. That was the only good thing I could find on the entire front page of CNN.com. Even reality TV shows, if you think about it, which have taken over the world, by the way. There's a reality show for everything. There's even pastors doing reality TV shows, which is just unbelievable. But they're all about bad news. There's drama. And take the family shows, like let's take The Voice or American Idol or one of those shows. Even on those family shows, really it's all about the drama. It's all about who gets voted off. It's all about whose dreams get crushed. You know, like, come on around, family. Let's watch this kid's dreams crushed forever. It's going to be awesome. He's going to be in depression the rest of his life. It's a family show. But that's what it is. It's bad news, and it sells. So we live in a world of bad news, and when you get enough bad news, you start to just anticipate bad news. You start to fear the worst. Some of you know people that are just negative. Something I've learned is to always understand there's something behind the characteristics that they're showing. So people that are negative all the time, it's probably because in their life they've had a lot of bad stuff happen to them. And a lot of us have had bad stuff happen to them. But I'm glad to give you a little bit of hope today. And we're going to talk about how to be brave in a world full of bad news, okay? Now, there's a writer in the New Testament named Paul, and he wrote like a third of the New Testament. He's one of the guys that really, really got Christianity going and basically gave his life to that. And he went through a lot. In fact, he was stoned, and I don't mean he lived in Colorado. I mean that people tried to kill him with rocks, okay? He was shipwrecked multiple times. He was beaten. He was imprisoned for years. So he went through all of this just trying to tell people about Jesus. Now, we have the freedom of it every day, but he was facing all that. And this is what he says in Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. Pastor Jonathan shared this in week one, but I want to look at it again. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Now, this is a guy that has faced bad news, bad news, bad news. And this is what he continues writing from prison, by the way, in verse 8. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, noble, right, pure, lovely, admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think on such things. And this is great reminders for us to live in a world of bad news. Have you ever known people, and maybe you're in the room, that say, I just don't even watch the news anymore. Just too much bad stuff on there. And I get it, because you're never going to see the local news even open up with a great story. It's always something bad, something tragic, something going on. Jess and I, when we were moving to San Antonio, we moved from a small country town where we knew everybody. You didn't want to go to Walmart because you were going to have 30 conversations because you knew everyone there. And we moved here. And I remember before we moved, though, I got online and tried to find out what the crime rate was like. Bad, bad idea. We were a little scared to move here. And obviously, everything's fine and it's safe where we're at. But the anticipation of bad news and the fear that came from looking at that really made us think heavily about moving here. There's another great example I want to share in the Old Testament, and this was the Israelites are on their journey to the Promised Land. It's a 40-year journey. They're trying to get there, but they're learning a lot on the way, and they've now reached the city of Canaan that they are supposed to go take over. And God tells Moses to send out some spies to check out the land. Go size up the enemy, and let's see what it looks like. And we'll take off here in Numbers 13. I want to just read a few verses. Numbers 13 in the Old Testament, verse 17, and it'll be on the screen for you here as well. When Moses sent them to explore Canaan, he said, "Go up through the Negev and on into the hill country. See what the land is like and whether the people live there are strong, weak, few, or many." And he continues to ask them to check out other parts of the land and so on and size up the competition. Verse 21, so they went up and explored the land. When they reached the valley of Eshcol, they cut off a branch bearing a single cluster of grapes. Two of them carried it on a pole between them along some pomegranates and figs. Verse 27, they gave Moses this account. So this is what they say we found. We went into the land which you sent us, and it does flow with milk and honey. In other words, it's very prosperous, very lush, amazing land. In fact, here's the fruit. They bring back this massive fruit on two poles as an example of what is there. Verse 28, it says this, but the people who live there are powerful, and the cities are fortified and very large. We even saw descendants of Anak there, which are literal giants. Then Caleb silenced the people. He's one of the 12 that went. He silences them, though, and says, Moses, and said this, we should go up and take possession of the land, for we certainly can do it. So most of them are grumbling, but one guy's like, hey, let's do this. Let's go get it. And verse 31, last two scriptures. But the men who had gone up with him said, we can't attack those people. They're stronger than we are. And they spread among the Israelites a bad report about the land they had explored. So let me recap it. There's 12 spies that enter Canaan. And now this is the land that God promised them. They get there and they see that it is everything they could hope for. It's amazing land. They bring back proof of it, in fact. They bring back this on two poles, this pomegranates and grapes and this fruit. 10 spies report that there's giants, fortified walls, they're outnumbered, there's no way. Two of them, Caleb and Joshua, though, they say, hey, we should go take this land before we can take the land. And what I learned here is there's two types of people, and this is true today. There's those who believe the promise of God over their present situation. And there's those that allow fear to destroy their faith and infect others. There's the 10 spies who are terrified, yet they really want that promise. And there's the two that understand that God's promise is greater than any giant they're going to face. And that's what I want to talk to you about for a minute. And I want you to really key on this. when we face things that are bigger than us, I want you to understand that God will use your weakness to show his strength. I used to hear messages growing up all the time, and they would say this, God will never put more on you than you can bear. And that's not true. God absolutely will put more. Here's the deal. Why would we need God if we can handle everything? Why would we ever need God in our life if everything we face we can do on our own? And if you're like me, you've tried to do things on your own. You've tried to make decisions on your own. You've tried to come through situations on your own. And you've learned that in your weakness, if we allow God's strength to come in, it not only will help us through things and help us through the bad situations and the bad news, but also his strength will show, and it will show to other people, right? Your weakness, God's strength. Think about this. The land was actually full of giants that could devour them. Like literal giants. Not just like CrossFit guys. Even though some of them were big too. Like literal big, tall giants. They were outnumbered. They had already been on this journey. And so it wasn't just a group of people that formed. I mean, they've been on this 40-year journey trying to get to this land that they should have got to rather quickly. They've got bad news all along the way. Bad things are happening. And these 10 spies, they've just kind of had it. They've had it. Look, everything is going wrong. We can't do it. They'd already made up in their heart that they were defeated. They'd already made up in their heart that God had left them, God had abandoned them, and they were looking through the eyes of what they could accomplish. They were looking through the eyes of what they could do in the midst of this bad news that, hey, this is a land full of giants that we are promised. And it makes me think that there's oftentimes in our life, just like these guys, who are carrying around proof of the promise on these poles of fruit, but they're allowing the giants in their life to keep them from what God actually promised them. And I think many of us as Christians, a lot of times we carry around with us the proof of God's promise because we're here today. Some of you are in the room today is proof of God's promise and faithfulness. You are only here because of God. And we carry that around with us sometimes, but yet we allow the giants in our life that we face, the things that are bigger than we are, that even though we're carrying that proof around, we never allow ourselves to actually get to where God promised us. So what are the dreams that God has put in you? What is it that God has put in your heart? And what are the giants in your life that are keeping you from taking that step? I know a lot of times there's people around us that can keep us from taking that step. A lot of times we can tell people what God has put in our heart, and to them it's bad news. I know for me, like ministry, going from a great job and stepping into ministry, for a lot of my friends, man, they could not understand that. That was a terrible move, a bad move. And if I allowed their voices to affect my decision-making, I wouldn't be where I am today. Sometimes people can't take the journey with you. Those 10 spies couldn't take the journey. In fact, those 10 spies, they didn't make it to the promised land. You know, Caleb and Joshua are only two of a few of the original Israelites in Egypt that actually made it into the promised land. Can you imagine that 40-year journey of thousands of people and only a few of the actual original Israelites made it into the promised land? I want you to know that God is bigger than your problems. Someone here, I believe, has been on a journey that's been driven by fear, and maybe you grew up in a home where there's a lot of negativity. Maybe you grew up in a home where you got a lot of bad news, and maybe you just feel like that's going to continue. Maybe you're surrounded by influences that point to the worst. Maybe there's a promise in your heart that God wants to fulfill, but fear owns you. I want to give you just three quick ways to help you overcome bad news or the anticipation of bad news and allow you to be brave in this world. All right, number one is this. I want you to always remember his promise over the present situation. His promise is over the present situation. Whatever you're dealing with, what are you facing right now? For my wife and I, we're about to have our first child. And that is so scary. Like, is anyone else terrified when you had your first kid? Maybe you're always terrified. But it's scary. Like, we go into these doctor visits, and they do the sonograms, and they check every little part, and it's just a scary process. The day that we have the baby, okay, I don't do real well in those settings, okay? I'm terrified of that. But I know God's promise is bigger than my present situation. Hey, 10 spies, that land has already been promised to you. Spying on it is a formality. God already made the promise. Just go take it. What has God promised you? Stop allowing giants to hold you back. Go take it, his promise, over your present situation. What has he promised you? Well, there's over 3,000 promises in the Bible. Some of those are promises to specific people, but a lot of those are promises to us as Christ followers. Let me give you a couple. Number one, he promises to meet all your needs in Philippians 4:19. That's pretty awesome. He promises that his grace is greater than any sin you could commit in 2 Corinthians 12:9. He promises eternal life for his believers in John 10:28. That's just three of many promises that you have as a believer. His promise over your present situation, whatever the news is, whatever you're facing, whatever you're anticipating. As Pastor Jonathan said last week, believe God, don't just believe in God. These 10 spies, they failed to believe God. Believe God. Number two, how can we be brave in this world of bad news? Number two is faith over fear. Faith over fear. Psalms 112, this is the key verse for the day, and it says this, surely the righteous will never be shaken. They will be remembered forever. In verse 7, I love this. They will have no fear of bad news. Their hearts are steadfast, trusting in the Lord. Their hearts are secure. They will have no fear. In the end, they will look and triumph over their foes. They will have no fear of bad news. A little saying I use, and I've used forever, is this, your story over your worry. Your story over your worry. It's another way of saying faith over fear, but your story over your worry. And this is what I mean. What has God done in your life? What has God done? Okay, so for these 10 spies, this is what God has done. He brought them out of slavery. He parted a Red Sea that they could walk across and crush their enemy behind them. He gave them water from a rock. He gave them food that actually rained down from heaven. He gave them a promised land. Somehow, though, they forgot all that stuff. They allowed their worry to control them and to keep them from God's promise. In your life, what has God brought you out of? What is your story? And allow your story to be a reminder of God's promise to you, and allow your story to trump the worry in your life, no matter what you're facing. God will always be bigger than your problems. The third way that we can face the bad news in a bad news world is to be reminded that we are designed for a destiny. This is a pretty cliche thing, and I've heard a million messages on destiny and the plans for your life and all that, but I want to give you just some real basic stuff here that's true. And every one of you, hopefully you know this, God is not wasteful. God doesn't make mistakes. God is very resourceful. So that being said, we should know that God created all of us with purpose. Like, he had an intention for every one of you in this room. He put you on earth not just to go live your life, but he put you on earth for a destiny. And many of you maybe know that and know what it is, and some of you are still saying, I'm still trying to figure out what God wants for me. Well, let me help you. To know your destiny is simply this. Know God and your destiny will follow. Know God and your destiny will follow. The closer you know God, the more you know God, the clearer his plan for your life. And the clearer his plan for your life, the more that when you face bad news, you'll be more understanding of God's hand in it. If you don't read your Bible and if you don't pray a lot, I want to challenge you. I want to challenge you to carve out some time every day just to pray. Maybe it's on your way to work. Maybe it's first thing in the morning or before you go to bed. I want to challenge you, if you don't read your Bible, get a YouVersion app on your phone And there's tons and tons and tons of devos that you can get on there and read every day for 5 minutes. But just start getting to know God a little better and find out how clear God's plan for your life will become. Get to know Him. He wants to know you. Isn't it awesome that we serve a God that wants to know us? We don't serve a God that we do all these pagan practices and these remembering of a God that died. We have a living God that loves us and wants to know us. That's amazing. Get to know God. Let me tell you this as I close. I said earlier, I don't do well in hospitals. In fact, Jess and I went and toured the hospital where we're going to have our baby boy. And many of you have probably done that before. It's just an empty, clean room. And while we were in there, I literally was about to pass out with like 8 other couples, and everyone's staring at me like, what is wrong with you? I don't do well with that. I almost didn't take a job one time because they told me I had to get a TB shot. And I'm like, I don't think I want that job after all. Like, I'm scared of that stuff. My brother and I both are. My brother, if anyone else, even an animal, throws up, he instantly throws up. It's just like, oh, you threw up? I'm going to throw up. So that's kind of how I am. Well, Jess and I moved here in March, and after a few months, I started losing a lot of weight. And, you know, that's all good and stuff, but I wasn't trying to lose weight, so maybe it was thank you, Lord. But started feeling a little sick, and so we went to the doctor on July 4th. And went to a little walk-in clinic. No one was there. Everyone was with family and friends. So it's just me and the doc. And doc has me come back, and he's like, let me run a few tests on you. And he's like, we're going to have to prick your skin and get some blood. I'm like, oh, are we sure? Can we do anything else? Is that the only way? Yeah, we're going to have to. So they did that on my finger, and it was terrible. And they went back. They did a few things. And he comes in, and this is his exact words. On July 4th, Brad, I have some bad news. You are a diabetic. What? I'm healthy. I broke my arm once, but that's it. I don't get sick or anything. It's like, I'm sorry, man. Yeah, you are. In fact, your levels are so high, you really should probably go to the ER. Like, okay, wow. So we went home, and I, on my way home, got on my phone, which is a terrible idea, and started really looking into diabetes, because I had friends that were diabetic, but I didn't know a lot about it, other than the basics. And, you know, don't ever WebMD things. It's like you have every disease possible if you look on there. So I basically had one day to live, and I got home, and I went in my bedroom, and I just had it out with God, and I looked like some of those kids that wanted to try Skittles. I was upset, man. I was laying in my bed. My wife, she made up a reason to leave. She just left the house because I was in my room. God, why? Why would you do this to me? How is this happening? This can't be. And I was terrified. And so we go back to the doctor for several weeks, and it's amazing the shift that happened in my life. And so I'm glad I get to talk to you about this today because I got to apply it in my own life. I started thinking about God's promise for my life. I started thinking of His promises in my life. Then I started thinking about the times where God has been so faithful to me. And I started thinking about the fact that God has a destiny for my life and where He's brought me from and where I am and how I've been hand in hand with God through this journey of life, and it's been amazing. And suddenly my faith began to grow. Suddenly I wasn't having those conversations with God anymore. In fact, I knew what they were doing for me wasn't working. And I pretty much knew in my heart at that point that they were going to diagnose me as a type 1 diabetic. And that's quite a bit worse. And we went in, and the doctor's like, Brad, I hate to tell you, man, but you're type 1 diabetic. You know, the good news is if you just take care of yourself and do like 500 million things every day, that you can still live a long life. I took it with a smile. Like, all right, man, I know God's with me. I told him I was a pastor. I'm like, hey, man, I'm a pastor. I believe God's with me in this journey, and it's cool. And over the next few weeks, started learning. I'm into technology, so I started learning all this new technology, started changing up my eating habits. My poor wife has to cook a lot more broccoli now than she ever wanted to. Changing up how, you know, kind of cut out all the breads and cut out all the sugar, except for my wife, if you know what I'm saying. And we are having a kid, so... Anyway, just totally took us off board there. But so I've been able, though, on this journey, man, I've been able to help other people. And I've seen God's hand in the face of bad news. And I know some of you have gotten way far worse bad news than that. But it's just an example of how when we have God's promise over our present situation, when we have that faith over fear, and we remember that God created us for a purpose and a destiny, no matter what you face, God is with you. He'll take you by the hand. He'll walk you through it. And his purpose for your life will start showing up. I got to be a part of a video a few weeks ago that went out to thousands of people talking about if they just got diagnosed, which is something I really should have watched when I was diagnosed. I've got to connect with some new friends, a pastor in Conway, Arkansas, who was diagnosed the same week as me. And we've been connecting and talking about new technology, and it's been awesome. In fact, in San Antonio is the first place that they have ever started working on a prosthetic pancreas, right here in San Antonio. So God's hand has been in it, and I just want that to be a small example for you as you go through this journey. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for your purpose for our life. Thank you, God, that you're bigger than any problem we ever face, anything we ever go through. God, that your promise is so much bigger, your promise is so much greater. And I pray for every person in this room today that may be facing some things, that may be walking on their own, that may be trying to do it on their own, God. Lord, you will put more on us than we can bear, but Lord, in our weakness, your strength will shine. And I just pray someone leaves encouraged today. I pray someone leaves here today knowing that you haven't abandoned us. You haven't left our side, Lord, but you're just asking to be a part of the journey. God, we don't have to face it on our own. We don't have to go through the bad stuff on our own. You want to walk with us, God. And I just ask that you would walk with these sweet, amazing people at NorthRock. And I pray that it would be an encouragement to them and help others around them. And as we continue to pray, I would be remiss if I did take an opportunity to just ask if there's anybody in the room that today would like to just surrender their heart completely to Jesus. Maybe you've been living a selfish life. Maybe you've been living a life just on your own, and you've been trying to take on the giants of your life all by yourself. And today you feel like is the day that you want to just give it all to him. I'm not going to embarrass anyone, but I would like you, if you want to be included in that prayer, just so I know who I'm praying for, if you would just lift your hand boldly today, just for me and the pastors, would you just lift your hand right now? If I could pray for you, thank you. Anybody else want to join these in the room? Today you want to surrender your heart. Thank you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Thank you. Wow. It's my pleasure to pray for you in this moment. Lord, thank you so much for these hands in this room and what they signify. God, they signify the very reason that we are at NorthRock exists, for people to surrender their life to you and to allow you to begin to lead their life. And I pray for every hand in this room, Lord, on this journey that they begin right now, God, that you would walk with them. Lord, that they would know the more they know you, the clearer you become, and the clearer your calling, your destiny for their life becomes. God, I thank you that they have this chance today to start their life brand new, fresh, and with you at the forefront, God, of everything that they do. In your precious name. And everybody said amen. Let's give a big hand to these people. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.